Welcome to the Fan of History. We are doing the second part of our Sparta trilogy. This is Life in Sparta. This is a special show because the main show is the narrative, and it will continue when we are done with Sparta. You should watch Legends of Sparta first to learn where Sparta came from. But this time we're going to talk about what it was like to live in Sparta. So we'll talk about Spartan men. We'll not talk too much about Spartan women, because that will be part of the next show. We'll talk about the Periokliai and the Helots and the Spartan states. And then we'll talk about Spartan warriors. So you have to serve the Spartan state. Everything in Sparta was geared towards preserving the Spartan state and the Spartan way of life. Remember, the Spartans are ultra conservative, and the most important thing in the world is the state. And if you did not conform, if you do not conform, if you try to be different in Sparta, you must die. So there's no room for free thinking or weaklings. And they have to be purged, exiled, or killed. There were three social classes in Sparta. You could be an equal, then you were a Spartan citizen, and it's really hard to become an equal. We'll talk about that today. You could be a free person, but not be an equal. And there were many different ways to end up in this pretty poor position where you're not an equal. I will talk more about that. You could also be a helot, and there were also other slaves in Sparta. But first we'll look at the life of male Spartan citizens. Next episode will all be all about Spartan women and sexuality. And then we will discuss the non-equals and the helots. This is a slaving society. Slavery was extremely important to Sparta. All manual labor was done by slaves. This is traditionally looked at as one of the roughest, most despotic slavery societies of all time. And we shall see if that is the case. So, as I said, ultra-conservative. Until the fall of Sparta in the 4th century BC, the society changed much less than any other city-state in Greece. But it did change. But it was... Sparta is so different from all the other Greek city-states. There were never tyrants in Sparta, and tyrants were the rulers that were not kings. That became very, very popular in Greece. But Sparta always fought the tyrants and always kept their two kings. Kingship became a very dated thing in the rest of Greece. And they went away from the kingship, they went to tyrants, and then they found different ways of government, which were different from each city, for including democracy in Athens. But Sparta always had its two kings. So, let's talk about what it was like to be a Spartan man. Once you are born, your main goal is to become an equal, one of the Spartan citizens. And if you fail at this at any point, you would become a Periokliai or a corpse. You probably would not end up as a slave if you were born to Spartan parents. So, you all heard this, that the Spartans threw the babies off the cliffs. So was that true? Well, when a boy was born, he was brought before the council of elders. And if the council of elders says, this child is weak and he will not be a good Spartan stock, no strong Spartans will come after this child. He was actually killed, but he wasn't thrown off a cliff. There has been they haven't found any cliff with a lot of baby corpses. But the child, the boy child, was taken to a hillside and left to die by the elements. It is said that some of these children were rescued by other Greeks and lived in other parts of Greece. But this did not happen to Spartan girls. And when you were very small, you were told a lot of stories as a Spartan. All the stories were tailored to make you into a very bold and clever person, so that you could serve the Spartan state. So, at the age of 7, we're still talking about the boys here, you went into the agoge. And there is some evidence that foreigners, that is non-Spartans, could actually enter this system if or send their children into this system. And they would then not become Spartans, but they would be respected in Sparta. So, at the age of 7, the boy leaves his family and he severs the ties to his family. He no longer, of course, he has the family and he has an emotional attachment to it, but he is not allowed to see his family very often. And it is much harder than sort of a, like an in like a school where you go to live. But they did not receive military training, but they received harsh discipline, lots of sport and tea games, very physical. The Spartans were very, very focused on being fit and being well trained. You were given too little food. You didn't get enough food. And we'll talk more about Spartan food, and Spartan food is horrible. But you did not get enough food to survive. So you would have to steal food. But that was not allowed. So you would be punished if somebody caught you stealing food. So then you had to learn how to steal the food without getting caught. And if you didn't do that, you just starved to death. You were not allowed shoes and you were not allowed very many clothes. You would learn to take pride in pain and hardship. And you would train in boxing, swimming, wrestling, throwing the javelin, discussion, and fighting. But it was mostly unarmored fighting. You would be exposed to the elements. You would learn to endure cold water, rain, snow, if you can find snow anywhere close, up in the mountains, I guess. And you would receive an older mentor. This would be a man about 20 years of age. It's probably a man between 20 and 30. And you probably did not have sex with that person. So there is a very common misunderstanding that the Spartan boys had sex with their mentors, but they did not. And we'll talk more about that in part 3 of this show. So I'm going to give you an example of how hard life was for these boys. And it's the race for cheese, because Spartan food was horrible and you were not allowed to eat cheese. But once a year, I think it was once a year, it was at regular intervals, there would be a race. And all the boys would run through Sparta towards an altar. And while they ran, people would whip them, beat them. It was like running the gauntlet. And you had to run slow enough so that you bled, because the first boy to reach the altar and bleed on it would win the cheese. And then you could get to eat one piece of cheese. And this was highly valued. And of course, it was a great honor to win. But you couldn't just run really fast, because then you didn't bleed. So you had to stay, take a beating, and then run. And the whole agoge system was incredibly traumatic, extremely hard and tough on the boys. And it completely brainwashed the Spartan boys into becoming fighting machines for the Spartan state. At the age of 18 then, if you have not been kicked out of the agoge, it could happen, and then you would become a periocle and you would never have a chance of becoming a citizen. But you're not a citizen at 18. You're not an equal, because now it's time to go do the military service. And you're doing 2 intense years of military training. And the focus is on drill, the focus is on fighting in the phalanx and doing maneuvers as told. And the Spartans excel at being able to control their phalanx, their fighting unit. The physical fitness demands remained, the hardships remained, and these 2 years were extremely hard. And you could also fail here, get kicked out and never become an equal. Okay, you're still in the system and you're 20. Now you're allowed to grow a beard and grow your hair long. And the Spartans actually have beards from the age of 20. They look very much like the Amish beards. So the Amish have their beards for to show that they're peaceful, I think. I might be wrong there. But the Spartan beard, which looks exactly the same then, is extremely warlike. and only you, if you failed in the system, you lost the right to have a beard, and you would then have to shave because you didn't have the honor of having a beard. And that's what you did when you gave up. You shaved and became non-equal. But these guys that are still in the system, wearing their beards, they are not equals yet. And then you were assigned to be the mentor of a boy that entered the agoge. A 7-year-old that you were not allowed to have sex with. And there's reason to believe that actually if you did have sex with this boy, you would be killed. You were his role model and his father figure because he was not allowed to meet his real father. Your life is in the barracks with the other soldiers, but you are allowed to marry, but you could not live with your wife or children, but you could have children here. But very few Spartan women would marry someone who was not an equal, and you are not an equal, so good luck with that. But you were allowed to go to war, and the highest honor is to die for Sparta on the battlefield. You're only allowed to have a gravestone in Sparta if you die in battle, even if you are the king. And if you don't die in battle, then no gravestone for you. There is only one other way to get a gravestone, and we'll talk about that in the next episode. At the age of 30, it's time for the most important thing in your life. You are now judged on what you have accomplished. Are you good enough to be an equal? And you are judged by your unit of 15 men. No, you're judged by everyone who has been part of your training. The agoge, the military service, and these 10 years of being a Spartan soldier. And if there is one equal who has met you and says to the council that this guy is not fit to be a Spartan, then you have to shave and you are non-equal. You're still free, you're not a slave, but you're not an equal, and you can never ever be one. But if you succeeded, everybody agrees that you have what it takes to be an equal. You're a brainwashed drone of Sparta. Then you become the equal, the full citizen of Sparta. But as an equal, you are never allowed to eat with your family. You are assigned to a club of 15 men. This is your fighting unit. These are the guys you will fight with on the battlefield, and you have to bond with them. So you have to eat every meal with them. You can now have a house, have a family, go home, stuff, but you cannot eat in your own home, and you cannot eat with your wife. But now you have a really good chance of finding a wife, because the Spartan women wants to marry an equal. And you will probably marry a teenage girl. We'll talk more about that next time. So, what did you actually get for all this trouble? You have spent 23 years being abused. Ooh, you get a plot of land of equal size, just the same size as the land that the king has, or the council of elders. And you were also assigned 7 helots, 7 slaves belonging to this land, because the helots do not belong to individual equals, they belong to the land. But you get the land, so you get the helots for the land. And now you can build a house, but you have to build it with your own hand, so this is an exception to slave labor. And you can only use a specific amount of building materials, and you can only use a specific amount of tools, meaning that your house will look exactly the same as the house of any other equal. So these 15 guys then, which you have to eat with every day, you also have to pay them. You have to pay a certain percentage of whatever your land produces, because there is not really money in Sparta. And you would have to go to war with these men, and this is an old Dorian practice that also dies out in the rest of Greece. But this is a Dorian fighting unit that shared a tent and a sun shelter during the nomadic times. And this might have been what was called a phratry later. Well, if you don't die and don't get the gravestone in battle, you could actually get to be the age of 60, and then you earn a very special right. You are now allowed to go home, and you don't have to go to war. You'll probably not be allowed to go to war for Sparta. This is bad, because you can now not die in battle and you won't get a gravestone. But being 60, having lived your entire life as an equal, means that you can now become one of the Council of Elders. But a spot in the Council of Elders only opens up if somebody has died. But the whole system then was made to exclude the weak, the eccentric, the free thinking, and make every Spartan equal, 100% loyal to the Spartan state. And you will see when we talk about Sparta that there are very few exceptions. There are very few traitorous Spartans. They are extremely loyal to the Spartan state and will die to defend it. So if you die then, you only get a gravestone. If you died in battle, I already said this. Here's a gravestone of somebody who actually managed to die in battle. So, maybe heard the expression that they lived like Spartans, they lived in a Spartan way. And there is then the Spartan food, and it's sort of like a black porridge. It's disgusting, and it's the only thing you're allowed to eat. You're not allowed to eat anything else. This is what you eat all day. And a visiting person, I think this person was from Athens, wrote that now I know why the Spartans do not fear death. They are already in hell. And he said this when he attended a Spartan dinner at one of these phratries. So, money. It was early identified by the Spartans that money made people corrupt. So, let's not have money. Gold and silver was forbidden in Sparta. They had money for practical reason. It was made of iron. There were rich iron mines in Laconia. So you could get really good weapons in Sparta. And you could get really crappy money. This meant that merchants avoided Sparta. Importing stuff to Sparta was really hard. But then you were not allowed to own a lot of things. So that didn't matter. Fortune tellers, harlots, charlatans, prostitutes, etc. They had nothing to gain in Sparta, so they went to Athens, to Corinth, to Argos instead. And this created a very solemn, very serious place. And everyone was really equal. If you had the honor of being an equal, you were the same. If you were an equal, but everybody wasn't an equal. We should also mention that even though the Spartans did not write down events, they did write things down, and they did a lot of dancing, singing, music. There was a lot of sport in Sparta, and Sparta actually had a very rich cultural life, of which much is lost today. But they were obsessed with the oracle at Delphi. And this was a mixed blessing for the oracle, because as I will mention later in the narrative, the oracle at Delphi was a giant scam that was extremely lucky and well run. But a problem was that there was a Spartan in Delphi writing down everything the oracle said and sending it to Sparta. So the Spartans kept records because they thought everything the oracle says is so important, we have to keep track of it. And this sort of kept the oracle honest to some extent. Let's talk about the equals then. There are two kings. They are the highest persons, the highest status in Sparta, but they are still equals. They only have religious duties, and they command the army in battle. There were the five overseers of the tribes. There was the 30-member council of elders. And there is the appella, the gathering of the equals. So, yeah, we talked about the kings last time. The sons of the Dorian king Aristodemus. And we got the two houses of kings, Agidae and Eripontidae. Um, And as far as I know, the kings remained the rulers of Sparta until the very end. The king was a both kings were members of the Council of Elders, even if they were not 60. And on campaign, the king had absolute power. And if two kings were present at the battle, you could have problems. And that will happen. I haven't been able to find the name of this place, but there is a famous battle when Sparta is supposed to destroy the new democracy of Athens. But it doesn't work out because both Spartan kings are there. And after that very epic failure for Sparta, only one king could go on campaign at any one time, and the other king had to stay at home. And this is what happens at the Battle of Thermopylae, for example. Leonidas commands the Spartan forces because the other king is not there. He has to stay put in Sparta while Leonidas is out. He stayed put for other reasons as well. We'll talk more about that. So the Council of Elders then had two kings and 28 elders. If you ever became a member, there was no way you could not become a member. I think you could be exiled under very extreme circumstances. But the Council of Elders could only propose things. They could make proposals and they could call for the Appella, the Assembly of the Equals. But the Council of Elders could not make decisions. Here are the ephors then, the overseers per tribe, and their main task, their original task, was to oversee the agoge, the training system. But from 754 BC, they got a very special extra job. They had to declare war on the helots every year. Yes, the helots, the slaves, 7 helots per piece of land. But the ephors declared war on them every year, and this way you could kill your slaves without incurring the wrath of the gods. So it was very important to declare war on the helots. And the helots is a constant problem for Sparta because there is a small number of equals and a large number of helots. And slave rebellion is the one thing the Spartans fear the most. So the Appella, the gathering of the equals, it receives proposals from the Council of Elders. If you're an equal, you're allowed to speak at the Appella, and the Assembly will approve or reject the proposals. And if the Assembly approves something, it becomes Spartan law. So this is a society ruled by the equals, but it is also tightly restricted and should not be confused with the democracy. So then you could be free, but a non-equal. And that meant that you were free in some sense. You were not a slave. You were allowed to fight for Sparta. Actually, you were supposed to fight for Sparta. You were allowed to have a job. And if you were an equal, you were not allowed a job. You were a soldier. And if you were not, if you were free but non-equal, you were a wimp. This was bad. You had much lower status than the equals. Somehow along the line you had failed. You were allowed to live in Sparta. I think you were allowed to own slaves. One question I haven't been able to figure out was if you were allowed to have property. But I don't know. If you know, let me know. So you had different kind of free but non-equal people. So you could be an emancipated slave. If you were a slave, probably not a helot, there were other slaves, you could be free, as in many slavery societies, and then you were free but non-equal. You could also be a foreigner living in Sparta. Foreigners were allowed to live in Sparta, and some chose to do so while avoiding their own city-states for some reasons. You could also be an inferior. That was the people who failed the test, probably at 30 then, but could also fail earlier. You could also be a periokliai, and those were the dwellers around, because when the Spartan state conquered Laconia, the other people in Laconia were assigned the role of the Periokliai. So if you are Laconian but not a Spartan, you're also free but non-equal. So first they expelled the foreigners, but then they decided that they needed them. So the five villages became Sparta, had 100 other villages in Laconia. And Sparta decided at that state of development, not the state of development, decided to freeze the villages should exist but remain the same size, and kept tight control of them. Sparta made the foreign policy decisions for these other villages, but they could still manage their internal affairs and their own military service to the kings of Laconia, and the kings of Laconia were the Spartan kings. But there was one specific Spartan village that did not manage to obtain this status, and it was Helos. Helos owned rich lands by the mouth of the Eurotas, the river. It had open access to the sea, and when Sparta attacked this place, Argos went in and tried to protect it. But the Achaeans were evicted, Dorians moved in, and these Dorians became the Periokliai. So by 750 BC, Laconia was controlled by Sparta. And you would think that these Helots were the Helots, but they were not. So let's talk about the Helots. This is not attributed to Lycurgus. There were these slaves in other Dorian states. They were like serfs. It was the most miserable of all the slaves in Greece. They had constant slave rebellions. And there was this war against the Helots. So, this was the village of Helos by the Mediterranean. It owned rich land by the mouth of the Eurotas, the river. It had open access to the sea, and it resisted Sparta with military aid from Argos. So theory number one is that the first Helots were the people of Helos. This theory was disputed already in antiquity. But it is a fact that by 70 BC, Sparta was in control of all of Laconia. 750 BC, Sparta was in control of all of Laconia. And there were Helots. But Helots might have been around since the Dark Age, even since before the invasion. One other theory is that Helots are just slaves, and slaves come by being defeated in battle. There is another theory saying that the Helots came from a failed rebellion, and all the people were made slaves who participated in this rebellion. After the Messenian Wars, the Messenians will become the Helots, and this is the usual explanation you hear where the Helots come from. They were defeated in the Messenian War, but this is not the case. The Helots were around before that. So even if it is not clear where the Helots came from, or if there were other slaves in Sparta, we can talk about what it was like to be a Helot. This is not something that Lycurgus came up with. There existed similar serfdoms or slavery in other Dorian states. Some people said that this was the most miserable of all the slaves in Greece, whereas other writers from antiquity say that the Helots were somewhere between a free man and a slave. But there was a constant fear of slave rebellion, and as I said, war was declared against the Helots. There were 7 Helots for every piece of land, so and one Spartan equal had one piece of land. So if you were a Helot, you had to work the land, you belonged to the land, and 50% of what you produce from the land must go to your master, but not more than that. So this is a sign that being a Helot was actually better than being a regular slave. Because if you exacted more than 50% from your Helots, you were cursed by the gods. And it was also part of the system that if you were a male child of Helots, you were judged and exposed just as the Spartan boys were. And actually, the Helots fought for Sparta at some points. So the status of being a Helot is extremely complicated. And it becomes even more complicated when you think about the Kryptae, the secret police of Sparta. This was part of the Agoge, and some says Lycurgus introduced this, but others says it comes later. This is a way of earning honor and increasing your chance of becoming equal. The Kryptae control the Helots. They check the Helots for signs of rebellion, but they also murdered, just outright murdered, the strongest of the Helots to prevent the Helot uprisings. So, and this was a good thing, thought the Spartans. I doubt that the equal that had the piece of land with the strong Helot thought that this was a good idea. But such was the work of the secret police. So, what about Spartan warriors then? Were they as good as people say? A Spartan man could live his entire life thinking only about battle. He did not have to do any work. He didn't have to have a job, but he had to train, and fight, and fight, and fight. The entire culture is formed around war, and they have this constant war with the Helots to keep them on edge. And the Helots were mistreated just to keep them rebellious as well. And a strange thing is that the Spartans actually did not train a lot in actual fighting. They didn't train swordsmanship, or they trained at throwing the javelin, but they didn't train as we would train today as soldiers. They trained physical training, physical fitness, and discipline, and making maneuvers with your unit. And they have extremely good units. And that actually means that the Spartans were the best warriors history had ever seen, from about 650 BC to the end, if they fought as a group. They are actually at the end defeated by other Greeks, but by then Sparta is a shadow of its former self. And those 300 guys at Thermopylae, they were actually the best fighting unit of their time. If Sparta was really in trouble, they could arm the non-equals, and this happened on a regular basis, as the Laconians were forced to do military service, serving the kings of Laconia. But they could also then arm the Helots, and that meant that you ran into a lot of problems then, because you trained these slaves in fighting, you made sure that they had strong, healthy men, so they could make rebellions. But then you also murdered the strongest of them, so they were angry at you. Yeah, not a good place to be. So I think the Spartan edge in battle then comes from being in awesome shape. They could fight much longer than other people because they were just very well trained. They had endurance. They trained in phalanx maneuvers, but there are no phalanxes in the 8th century BC. And the Spartan phalanx, when it comes, it will also be have the special ability of moving backwards and turning much faster. Sparta's greatest weakness was the low number of equals. And that's why you had to arm the Periokleae and where you had to arm the Helots. So that's why the state is very much organized around increasing the number of equals, and that means childbirth. There have to be a lot of new Spartans, so we'll get back to that in part 3. There's also a PR machine. Spartans talk a lot about their prowess in battle, about their fascination with battle, and the rumor spreads quickly. So the rest of Greek, everybody knows that the Spartans are the most fearsome warriors. So Spartans will sometimes work as mercenaries, and this is why do they do this? Most of them are renegades in some way that want to get away from Sparta, but and Spartan generals are very much sought after as organizers of troops. There are Spartan mercenaries, so there must have been some people who left Sparta and were tired of being equal in this very totalitarian state. Let's talk a bit about Spartan religion before 500 BC. We talked a bit about the gods. We have the oracle at Delphi being very, very much adored by the Spartans. There is a worship of Hyacinthus of Amyclae. This was an Achaean cult that spread after Amyclae was conquered, and it seems to have been the most important cult until 500 BC. Athena Polyokos is the guardian of the polis, the god that he worshipped at the center of Sparta. You have Artemis Orthia, you have Menelaus and Helen being worshipped. There is a great wave of temple building starting at 800 BC all over Greece. And religion is of course a major factor why the Spartans come to consider themselves as Greeks instead of Dorians. So, and the Spartans are extremely religious and conservative, so they will make really bad decisions about war based on religion. For example, the Battle of Thermopylae, where you have 300 Spartans instead of 10,000 because it was bad for religious purposes to go to war, so you couldn't go to war. And those 300 cheated. Stay tuned to the Decade Reports. Next time we will talk about Spartan women and Spartan sexuality. Thank you for watching.